To Redeemed by Grace Fellowship, friends. It's good to see you. I hope you've had a good week. I know the Lord has blessed me despite myself. So, but anyway, I'm glad to see you. We have a great lesson today as we start digging into 1 Corinthians together a little bit. So, hope you had a chance to see the introduction that we did last week. If you haven't, it is still out there. Whether you're watching this on YouTube, Rumble, or Spotify, and we have some other sources soon to add these lessons to. As soon as we get those all ironed out, we'll roll them out for you. But do want to remind you before we get started to please subscribe to this channel, whether you're watching it on YouTube, Rumble, or Spotify, so that you never miss out on any of our lessons. And please, please also look for us on Facebook, Instagram. You'll find us also on X/Twitter. You will find us on True Social, LinkedIn, and Pinterest as well. Just go find us on everything, and there you go. You got it all, right? But yeah, please subscribe so that you don't miss out on anything. And also, please make sure you hit that thumbs up, like button, so that it does get out on the algorithm to see more and more folks. And one of the best things we can do with this these lessons is to share them with your friends. Hit that share button and share it out to public or whatever you want to do so that more and more people can hear the gospel. And that's what we're called to do, right? Sure is. Well, before we dig into our outline for the day, let's go ahead and open in prayer. Pray with me, please. Almighty God, we're just so thankful that we can get together to fellowship with each other and with you. And we pray, Lord, that you would clear our minds of the clutter of life, that we might hear you speak as we open up your word. Yeah, that's right, your word that you penned through Paul. And Lord, that we might gain understanding of what it is that you would have us apply to our lives. Doesn't matter that these events might have occurred 2,000 years ago. What matters is how you intended it to apply for us each and every day and throughout the centuries. We just thank you for that, Lord. Again, we ask you to continue to bless Redeemed by Grace Fellowship, to continue to grow our membership, that more might hear the gospel and respond to you. And we thank you for such a privilege. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. All right. Well, let's take a look. Again, we are going to be looking today at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, the first 17 verses of that. We will listen to it read to us here in a bit. So if you have your copy of God's Word, you can go ahead and get it ready. Or if you're using a Bible app, feel free to open it up to that as well. Or if you don't have either, if you'll be watching this on video, you will see the words on the screen. But if you're listening to audio only, well, you'll hear it read. So you won't miss out any which way or form. So, but we'll get to that as well. And again, you'll find us not only here on YouTube or Rumble or Spotify, but you will also find us on Facebook, Twitter/X, TikTok. You'll find us all over the place. So just check it all out and pass the word on as well. So I'm going to go full screen with this. So those of you that are watching video will be able to see the screen. And those of you that are listening to the audio, you're not going to miss anything because we're going to read it out loud for you as well. So as we've mentioned in our introduction, Corinthians, we're going to be looking at an outline in which the Apostle Paul is going to be led to present certain themes based on the things that are happening in the Corinthian church. And again, I say those applications apply today because the same things are happening here, even in a different culture. But the same ideas are still there. So first he's going to introduce, in his introduction, he's going to talk about the calling and the benefits of sainthood. And we'll probably see that in the first 9 verses today. And then we'll also begin to take a look at the disunity in the church, starting in about verse 10. And we'll stay on that theme probably all the way to the middle or end of chapter 4 when we get there. But we're also, as we get to verse 10 today, we're going to also see the counter to that, and that is the need for unity and why. And we'll see that occurring not only from verse 10, but all the way to chapter 3 as well. After that, then we will move into the need for servanthood in chapter 4, the immorality that's going on in the church. And again, that's in the church, not outside the church, but in chapter 5 and 6. And we'll see, talk about marriage in the church in chapter 7, and liberty in the church in chapter 8, worship in the church. We'll begin at 11, liberty in the church will actually go all the way up to that point. So really, I said chapter 8, but it'll go all the way to chapter 11. And then 11 will pick up the worship in the church. We'll see the roles of men and women in the church. Again, starting in chapter 11. And we will look at the Lord's Supper in the church as well. Chapter 11. 11 is going to be a nice one to study. And then we'll be looking at spiritual gifts coming in chapter 12, and that'll carry on all the way to chapter 14. And that's an important thing to understand what those are and what they're not, based on the things we see in the world today. And so that'll be an interesting study when we get there. We'll look at the hope of the church, the resurrection, that is, and that will be in chapter 15. He kind of touched on that a little bit in the first 2 letters he wrote to the Thessalonians that we have already gone through in this Pauline epistle study. If you missed those, that's okay. They're out there. Go check it out. You haven't missed anything. It's always at a click of a mouse for you or a touch of a finger, depending on the device you're using. But then we're going to look at Paul giving a charge to the church in chapter 16, along with stewardship and along with his personal plans and greetings as he continues in his ministry. We can remember as he has gone through a lot of these things with us that he has actually, at the time of writing this letter, he has left Corinth and is in Ephesus right now. He's gone back to Ephesus and revisiting that church, and he's getting wind through messenger of some things that are happening back in Corinth that he needs to address, and thus he pens this first letter. And he will also later on send a second letter based on some other things as that. And it's not all some problem areas. He's also given an encouragement and things like that. We have to remember, as Paul's gone through these missionary journeys, he's had these groups of Judaizers is what they're called. It's coming up behind him and trying to discredit him and discredit Peter and discredit the other apostles and things like that, because he is not including the legalism that was a part of Judaism within the framework of this Christianity that is being preached. And so there's a problem there, and it will stay intact for a while, but it's a way that Paul gives us encouragement today. We might not have Judaizers out there, but we have all kinds of other things trying to attack Christianity, and so we have to pay attention. We get discouraged when we hear all that stuff, and some people flat out they probably leave the church, which that would be a sign that they weren't genuinely of us to begin with, or they'd be back, but because there'd be no other choice, right? I mean, Christ is Christ, and so those are all things that we'll be kind of taking a look at as we go forward. But before we do that, we do want to hear the scripture read to us. Again, I've promoted these many of times on that you can pick up these. I always recommend three, but there's you can pick these up for free and download them on your favorite device. And not only are they great study tools while we're reading our scripture and we're studying the scripture and we're praying through the scripture, to get go on those resources, to get commentaries, to get maps, to get whatever tools you might need to better understand what it is that you're reading and studying about. And hopefully as you're studying, you're asking questions like who, what, when, where, and why. Why is this being mentioned here? What does it have to do with the price of beans in Boston? And what is all this about? So those are important questions for us to ask as we study God's word, but we need to seek those answers and to seek them from reliable sources that are not going to deface and demean the word of God. And so these apps could provide such sources that you can go through and take a look at that'll help. But one of the other tools that they have is the ability to play audio, allow this scripture to be read to you. And I find it a very good tool to do that, because there's a lot of times I miss something when I'm through my study because my mind was wandering off about the stuff I have to do today. And this gives us an opportunity to hear it and go, oh, I missed that. Oh, okay, I didn't think of it that way, that I hear it now. And so those are important for us as students of the scripture to do. And so using that tool, whether you're driving to work, whether you're out doing something in the outdoors in the lawn, or out washing dishes, whatever it might be, to pop in a good old earbud or headphone, whatever you do, and listen to it read to you. And so we're going to be using the Blue Letter Bible app today. It's going to read 1 Corinthians, but you other apps that you can use besides Blue Letter, Gateway Bible is a fantastic one, as well as Gideon's Bible app. Yeah, it's Gideon's International, the same people that put Bibles in the hotels and the hospitals, etc. That's the same group. They have an app out there too. It's a fantastic one you can use. So just download all three of them. you can go back and forth and use each one accordingly. So here we go. Should have it all queued up. So we'll fire this off and listen to the reading of 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 17.
The first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. Chapter 1. Paul, called by the will of God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those who in every place call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that was given you in Christ Jesus, that in every way you were enriched in him in all speech and all knowledge, even as the testimony about Christ was confirmed among you, so that you are not lacking in any gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will sustain you to the end, guiltless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same judgment. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there is quarreling among you, my brothers. What I mean is that each one of you says, I follow Paul, or I follow Apollos, or I follow Cephas, or I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one may say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power.
All right. Well, you know, Paul, he first attacked the serious problem of defilement in the church, yet he said nothing about the problem itself, as you heard in the text. He didn't really tell us what the specific thing was that he was addressing, but there is a problem. He did give us a hint of it that we'll kind of cover a little bit about halfway through here, but he didn't really just blurt it out what this problem is. So instead, he took a positive approach here at addressing the issue. He reminded them of their high and holy position in Jesus Christ, what it is that he has called us to be. He's given us life. He's taken us out of death to life, and now has also given us the opportunity to exercise, I guess, what you would call free will, because before salvation, there is none, because we're in bondage to sin. And so he, upon God calling us out of that and breathing into us new life, we see it from a different perspective. And so we don't know what the specific is that he gets, but this passage does describe the church that God sees. In fact, in verses 10 through 31, that we will see mostly next week, Paul described a church that humans see through the eyes of a human, as opposed to the eyes of what God sees. And what we are in Jesus Christ, positionally, friends, ought to be what we practice in our daily life. But we're humans, we're sinful, and we often fail at that. But the word church in itself in the Greek language means a call out people. A called out people is what that means. I think in our society today, when you say the word church, the first thing that pops in someone's mind is a building, you know, on the corner of Main and 7th Street or something, you know, but that's what comes through mind. But it's a group of called out people, of saints. And each church has two addresses, technically. Obviously, there is a geographical address. In this specific one is Corinth that we're talking about in Greece. And it has a spiritual address of Jesus Christ that is there. And the church is made up of saints. Again, that is people who have been sanctified or set apart by God. And a saint, by the way, is not a dead person who has been honored by people because of his or her holy life at all. It again is indeed the saints are the people that have been called out by God. And Paul wrote to living saints, people who through faith in Jesus Christ have been set apart for God's special enjoyment and use. And so we're going to start breaking down the text that we heard read. I will read through a couple of verses at a time, and then we'll stop and chew on those a little bit and kind of get a feel for what it is that God wants us to know from that before we move on to the next one. So I'm going to start reading by reading verses 1 and 2. And it reads, Paul called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes, who to the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people, together with all those everywhere who call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and their Lord and ours. Okay, so it's kind of a greeting here. And characteristically, Paul begins by naming himself and by identifying his position as apostle of Jesus Christ. There, if you recall, in our introduction to the Thessalonians letters, we saw that there's a problem where some people were attacking Paul's credibility even on that, and that was causing some concern. The main problem that they had with that was the fact that these people now came in and said, hey, the second coming's already come and you missed it. Paul must not have told you everything. And that had some concern, a big concern, and you can go see those studies if you want to see how it was handled. This is nothing new. So he calls it out on most of these letters that, hey, this is me. I'm writing this. Okay. And yes, he will have a scribe and dictate it to him most of the time. And then he'll sit down and pen the ending usually in his own handwriting. But which those churches, since he had been there, will recognize. So, he does stress his apostleship because his authority, again, has been challenged. And he makes it clear that he is an apostle by divine calling through God's sovereign will. Now, the word apostle means a sent one, and it connotes a commissioned messenger, if you will. And that's an important thing because a lot of people use this word apostle in the wrong way in today, and you have to be careful with that. Paul would have been the last called to be an apostle, and John would have been the last to live. Would be the last to die, is probably better said. And an apostle was one that was a witness to the resurrected Christ. And so it doesn't mean they were one of the disciples, the 12 disciples, but it does mean that they had been with the resurrected Christ. And so that's an important thing. But Paul links this Sosthenes to himself as a Christian brother. And so he evidently was one of the apostle's special helpers and presumably well known to the Corinthian church. That's an important part. So you have to ask that question, why? In fact, at another time, he was a leader in the Corinthian synagogue before he became a believer in it. At some point, he converted to Christ, and he went off to help Paul in his Ephesian ministry. So he is there with him. So Sosthenes also may have been a scribe for Paul, for he did have those skill sets. And it could be very well that he's penning this on Paul's dictation, but we don't know for sure according to the text. But that is something that we know that he was able to do. And so it's a possibility of that happening. But in our introduction last week, we learned that Sosthenes had been beaten for bringing Paul before the civil court in Corinth. And Paul mentioned him here because he was probably well known again to the Corinthian church, and that he's fine and he's with him. And that would have brought encouragement to the church back in Corinth. Now, the believers in Corinth are designated as the Church of God in this phrase. And that phrase has really Old Testament associations, as in the expression assembly or congregation of the Lord. That is also what that kind of refers to in the assembly of Israel. Would also be a term that you would see from the Old Testament, and that is the entire, not only the nation of Israel, but the people of Israel that were believers. And for Paul, this church at Corinth was considered a part of the universal Church of God. I think in our day today, the word Catholic actually means universal on that. So I'll say little c Catholic, where we know there is a denomination with big C that is using that term as well. But so that is what they're talking about. It's a universal, even though there's a church in Corinth, and there's one in Thessalonica, and there's one in Philippi, and of course Ephesus, and of course in Jerusalem. All throughout, there are these churches that are unified by Christ as a whole, and that's why he uses that term, is so that he is presenting this universal assembly of believers. And for Paul, this church at Corinth was considered a part of that universal body. And the apostle may have found it particularly useful in Corinth to distinguish the church from the secular assembly of Greek cities, which was the gathering of the citizenry in a city-state to discuss and decide, you know, matters of public interest, so to speak. So that was something that word might have been used for, but he just wanted to make sure there's a distinction in what they're talking about. And so the Corinthian Christians are described as here as sanctified. And that means, again, set apart in a holy position before God because of their spiritual union with Jesus Christ. And Paul goes on to emphasize that they're called to live as God's holy people. We're called to holiness. We know that's not possible in and of ourselves, but we're called to be holy people. And that is to die and give up the old self and live like the new creature that now has that free will, that now has that ability to choose between right or wrong, or being sinning against God or not sinning against God. And we have a conviction that comes from the Holy Spirit that dwells in us when we do mess up. And it's easier for us to then return through repentance. And repentance is a key word in this whole process. So that's an important thing that God has designed for this all to happen. So God, so we're to live as God's holy people. I mean, they're on an equal footing with the people of God everywhere. So Corinth is no better than Jerusalem, and Jerusalem is no better than Corinth. In the eyes of God, the believer is the believer. It doesn't matter if they're Jew or Gentile. That does not make a difference. Shows no partiality. So the unity of believers in Christ is shown by Paul's emphatic words that we see there in verse 2, that their Lord and ours. I mean, that's a key. There's a that we both unify in that together. Every believer in Jesus is sanctified. Every believer is set apart to God and released from the power of sin and actively being transformed into his image. That doesn't, we don't arrive at that until we either pass on to the next to be with Christ, or he comes again. At that point, we will never have the ability to sin again. And hard to believe, hard to understand, because our sinful nature is so strong. Here it is now. But that is what this transformation is doing. To transform him and to become transformed into his image means to be made perfect like him. And so that's what God is working for. So every one of us is going to be going through there. Therefore, Christians are called saints because of that. Holy members of his family. And friends, we should be zealous for good deeds. Zealous for good deeds. And never looking aside of those things. Verse 14. Or excuse me, verse 3. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace. Well, a greeting Paul used, he used this in almost all his letters of some form or another in this. And it basically, its basic meaning of grace, it means favor. And peace is a result of God's saving grace. Okay. And that favor is unmerited. It's something we did not earn. We don't deserve, but he gave it anyway. That is what grace is all about, and peace is a result of that. So if we continue to live in God's grace and to understand it and pursue his holiness through his grace and faith, we also will see more peace in our life. And though it also kind of carries a sense of a greeting here, but grace and peace also refer to the truth of redemption purchased by Christ. And it was of God's grace that the Corinthian believers even were saved, just as all Christians are saved. And through this redemption, Jesus Christ purchased peace with God for each and every sinner that will believe. And this grace and peace are from God and God the Father, and who planned redemption, and from Christ, and who purchased it on the cross for the justification of his people. So let's look at verses 4 and 6. They read, I always thank God for you because of his grace given to you in Christ Jesus. For in him you have been enriched in every way, with all kinds of speech and with all knowledge, God thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. Well, this looks at the past, basically, their salvation, and when God justified them in by undeserved and unrepayable love and mercy, forgiving their sin. Through the work of his son, not through their works and efforts, because we wouldn't choose God if we tried, but it's his grace to call us out. The Greek word translated means basically enriched. And it gives us our English word plutocrat, in fact, which is a very wealthy person. But the Corinthians were especially rich in spiritual gifts, but weren't using these gifts in a spiritual manner. And we can go through the New Testament when we see people misuse the Holy Spirit gift in ways. And, well, let's just put it this way. They're probably not here anymore. So, but as is a characteristic of Paul in his other letters, he begins by thanking God for those whom he is addressing and who he's writing this letter to. And he realizes that God has given them his grace through their union with Christ, enriching their lives and by their ability to speak about God and by their knowledge of him. And this is something that he gives us. He is thankful that the testimony he gave them was confirmed in their lives, which anybody that proclaims the gospel, that would be the most encouraging thing you can ever see, is how Christ is working in the life of the person that you proclaim the truth to. And they came to know Christ. Majority of the people we will proclaim the truth to will reject the message and die in their sin. And so this is an important thing to understand, that the Corinthians were especially rich in spiritual gifts, but weren't using them in the correct way. And again, Paul enriches their lives by their ability to speak about God, to proclaim God, and by the knowledge of him. I can hear people say, I just don't know what to say. I know I'm supposed to tell somebody about Jesus, but I don't know what to say. And basically what we learned from scripture, if you're born again, Holy Spirit's living in you. Holy Spirit will speak. You just open your mouth and let him and count and trust what he says will make sense. And you might even say, I didn't even understand what just came out of my mouth. And that's okay, because a lot of the prophets didn't understand what they were prophesying in the Old Testament, and yet they could not speak or utter anything that wasn't directly of God. And so same type of thing. We put that trust in them, that we proclaim the gospel as we're told to do, and let him do the rest, as opposed to thinking I'm doing something here. But he is thankful, Paul is thankful for that the testimony he gave them was confirmed in their lives. And the form of the verb, I think, that we see here indicates that Paul regularly intercede for believers at Corinth, as well as those whoever he had preached the gospel to. That grammar thing, if you look at grammar, sometimes it's I know probably in school we hated grammar, but I don't know if you, like myself, ever had a teacher made you diagram sentences and all that, but you know what, I find it very useful today when I'm looking at scripture. But that verb tense makes all the meaning in the world to know that it indicates that he interceded with them constantly and over again. It wasn't he did it one time and it was done, and that's important. But Greeks naturally put emphasis on knowledge and wisdom. Of course, they had all the philosophers, you know, Plato and Aristotle and all them. And so they're used to hearing that and putting emphasis on knowledge and wisdom. I mean, they were so well educated in some ways that even as Rome is in now, one of the servants of Rome once is, well, who's going to teach my children? Well, you bring in a Greek person that teaches. And there you go. And they learn all their schoolwork. It's homeschool back then, of course. And that's the way they could handle that. And they, but so they had all this knowledge and wisdom. They were certainly good at expressing their thoughts. And however, God had so enriched the lives of these Christians in Corinth in spiritual perception and expression that they had been given increased ability in speaking and knowledge. Use that special spiritual gift, it grows. And these two terms are interrelated, by the way, speaking and knowledge. For Paul uses a single preposition, the word in, to unite them. He is convinced that this was a real work of God's grace, because he saw his witness about Christ established in their lives and at the time of their conversion, and they heard about, he had heard about it ever since, and that was a good thing. I mean, the reference to knowledge, it should be construed to mean that the Corinthians possessed some hidden mystical knowledge by which they could, without the cross of Christ, somehow reach God and be saved. No, that's not what he's saying. While it's true that the latter heresy is known as Gnosticism, some thought they could actually do this. And Paul is speaking about a concrete knowledge based on the reality of Christ's person and his death on the cross. And so we see this phrase here in the middle. It's in verse 6, and it reads, God thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. And this as a reference to the moment of salvation when the gospel was heard and believed and settled in the heart. And at that moment, the enabling of verse 4, back at the beginning of this section we're looking at, took place, because one became the recipient of the grace of God. And that. So that's important for us to remember as we look at our own lives in that as well. All right, let's read verses 7 through 9. They read, therefore, you do not lack in any spiritual gift as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will also keep you firm to the end so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with the Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. So now Paul addresses himself to the Corinthians, a need for a present and future Christian living. He introduces the thought by, therefore, you do not lack in any of special gifts mentioned in chapters 12. We'll be actually looking at those later, 12 through 14. We'll see all those laid out before us. Because Paul indicates that each Christian isn't to exercise every gift. Rather, he seems to be referring to a more generality to God's grace, actively counteracting the sins and the faults so prevalent in the Christian congregation. Now, Paul expresses confidence that God will keep them strong and will present his people blameless before him at Christ's return, and for which they're eagerly waiting, just as we are. And Paul looks to the blessing of a future grace, as do we, and the Lord's second coming, his full glory, his full honor and majesty will be revealed in a blazing splendor, and at which time all true believers will be fixed solidly forever as holy and without sin in full resurrected glory and purity to live in heaven with God forever. Can you imagine that? Wow, I mean, just think about that in your own life. Praise be to God, right? Did they actually possess every spiritual gift? Again, I talked about the importance of asking questions, the who, what, when, where, and why. And some of you enjoy emailing us at rbgf22@yahoo.com questions that you have during your study of it that you want to see addressed. And so this is one of them that was sent in. Did they actually possess every spiritual gift? Well, because that's a kind of a debate out there. But Paul, perhaps Paul hoped to disarm his opponents with a slight sarcasm, if you will, or an exaggeration, or perhaps they did have all the gifts but weren't using them in a mature manner. But though the Corinthians possessed spiritual gifts, their church was plagued with strife. They fought about being spiritual, and Paul later wrote that love is a better measurement of spirituality than giftedness. The Corinthians, I mean, they saw themselves as a spiritually elite, if you will, having all they need, but they lacked the evidence of God's grace in their lives. It wasn't there. It wasn't there. And we've all seen people that claim all this piety in the church instead of a humility, but there was no evidence of their life of being changed and living accordingly. Now, that doesn't mean living without sin, because we all are going to sin, but there's a different way we react to it when we do that, when we are a genuine believer as opposed to the world. So, now, it's really not clear in verse 8 where he refers to here, in the pronoun he. I mean, it either refers to God the Father or Christ. I mean, Christ is the near antecedent in the sentence itself, but in light of the reference to God's faithfulness in verse 9, it's probably best taken as referring to God the Father. But through his power in strengthening, Christians will certainly become blameless when Christ comes again. And before continuing in a section that he's about to go into of Thanksgiving, Paul assures the Corinthian of God's faithfulness. He reassures them in that, and they need to know that right now, that God has called them initially into fellowship with Christ, and so he is faithful in completing the work, granting them every grace and gift for daily life. Now, observe the apostles' fivefold repetition of the name of Jesus Christ in this brief section. We see it several times here, that he's talking about that. I mean, all salvation, past, present, and future, is based on Christ's redemptive work. And he's coming again. And I can't wait. I'm sure you can't either. But that is important for us to remember. And friends, because of God's sovereign and unchangeable promise, believers are assured of this grace, past, present, and future, and will remain saved, assured of future glory at Christ reappearing. Salvation is assured for those who believe. You cannot lose it. You cannot lose it. If you're a genuine believer, you are assured. So, And he uses this phrase, by whom you were called. And this call, as always in the epistles of the New Testament, refer to an effectual call that saves. May God, who calls to salvation in heaven, will be faithful to give the grace needed to fulfill that call, to fulfill it all. All right. Well, let's look. I got one more thing here. We have, as we get into this next section, verses 10 all the way to 17, we're going to look at a fact of how Paul approached this problem of division in the church. And it's probably one we ought to pay attention to, because when we have to deal with this in the church as well, we need to understand how he did it. So first, he pointed to the unity of Christ. Only one Savior and one body. That's important, because that's the common ground. I mean, the world sees our church divided into many denominations, all contradicting each other and saying different things. But at the core, that unity of Christ is solid, and it must be, because it is about Christ. One Savior and one body. And then Paul reminded believers of their baptism, which is a picture of their spiritual baptism into Christ's body. Not a physical baptism, for going through that ceremony, it does nothing in itself, but it allows that individual to proclaim publicly what has already occurred in the heart, what God has already done in their heart to bring them about. So it's that spiritual baptism that the scripture talks about that brings us into Christ's body, the church. And then he took them to the cross. Takes them right back to the cross. I mean, the mention of the cross in verse 17 that we'll see at the end here sets up a long section of the power of the gospel versus the weakness of human wisdom that we're going to be looking at for a while. So that is kind of a neat thing. So let's start getting into this section. We're going to read verses 10 and 11. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all agree with one another in what you say, and that there will be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. My brothers and sisters, some from Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. Well, in light of the information that was given to him about the divisions back in Corinth and that's developed in a church, well, Paul strongly exhorts the Christians both positively and negatively. He begins by charging them to have a united testimony, and then adds his plea for an inward harmony in mind and confession about Christ. I mean, between these two positive exhortations, Paul introduced a solemn purpose that there may be no divisions in the Christian community at all. And the word divisions graphically conveys the idea of dissensions that were ripping the church. And he takes his exhortation through the authority of Jesus Christ, whose name they revere, and we should too. And he mentions that phrase that speak the same thing, and Paul's emphasizing the unity of doctrine in the local assembly of believers, not the spiritual unity of this of his universal church, but doctrinal unity, clearly and completely based on Scripture. And it must be the foundation of all the church for life. If you ever wander into a church that's not talking about the Scripture and digging into it and publicly reading it at every service, I hope the Holy Spirit brings conviction on you that this might need to be a place that's teaching truth, because it's teaching ways of society and the ways of the world and not the truth of the scripture. No matter how bad it steps on our foot, and it will. Sometimes it's like a 2x4 up the backside of the head. And sometimes we need that, don't we? I know I do. But anyway, that's it. A doctrinal unity. It's clearly committed to the doctrine, and commitment to the disunity of the doctrine will severely weaken a church and destroy true unity. In its place, there can only be shallow sentimentalism or a superficial harmony, if you will. And then we see that phrase joined together. And the basic idea is that of putting back together something that was broken or separated so it's no longer divided. And the term is also used both in not only the New Testament and in classical Greek to speak of mending such things as nets and broken bones or utensils or torn garments or dislocated joints, all those things, anything that same phrase could be used for in the classical Greek. But the demand is for unity internally in their individual minds and externally in their decisions made among themselves, but unified in truth by the beliefs and convictions and standards and behavior by applied principles of living. The only source of such unity, I hope you're listening to this, friends, the only source of such unity is God's word, which establishes the standard of truth on which true unity rests. No other. There's no other. And Jesus prayed for this unity of his fellow believers before his arrest and crucifixion. And Paul also made frequent appeals so that the believers may be one in Christ Jesus. I mean, the joyful unity of Christians is a powerful testimony to the world that the gospel of love that we preach is real, unique, powerful, and welcoming whoever will believe in the Lord. Let's look at verses 12 and 13. They read, what I mean is this. One of you says, I follow Paul. Another, I follow Apollos. Another, I follow Cephas. And still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? This is a problem that occurs even in the modern day, that people begin to follow certain people. Some of the times is a preacher, that they'll follow the preacher, not Christ. The preacher is a messenger and a shepherd that is proclaiming the truth, but he is not the truth that is Christ. And we forget that sometimes. And Paul had received word that about these divisions, which he calls quarrels in the Corinthian church. He heard it from a certain Chloe's house. Now, presumably all those quarrelings were Christians and were members of the church, and they were divided into four factions, as we see in these verses, each one of them having its own emphasis, following its own leader and acting in antagonism to the other three. And now, and that could be a big time problem. But how frequently a local church congregations today are likewise, divided into these little cliques, if you will. And at Corinth, these four groups center around four prominent leaders. First, There were those who claimed to be special adherents of Paul himself, and possibly because of his emphasis on the ministry to the Gentiles and a ministry to which many of them were connected. And then there were those who follow Apollos, who were enamored that of a learned and eloquent preacher that he came from Alexandria. And then there was the followers of Cephas, as Peter, basically, who no doubt impressed this apostle's emphasis on the Jews. And so, and then, of course, some of those would have probably been connected to him, Cephas, with the Judaizers, which would have been a false claim. But indeed, there was some thought to that, because we know from the book of Acts that God had to deal with Peter a little bit. And so we don't have time to go on that, but there is a study of the book of Acts out there you can check out on YouTube as well at from Redeemed by Grace Fellowship. So feel free to take a look at that. You'll see what we're talking about, but with Peter. But yeah, so there's all this put together. The mention of the Christ party, I guess, if you will, suggests that some Corinthians claims as, now, don't misunderstand what they're saying here, because it's a little different than what you might think. But they claimed a very special relationship to Christ, or placed a special emphasis on him, an emphasis that they felt the followers of Paul and Apollos and Cephas had neglected or didn't have. So they had some special gifts or whatever that the others didn't get. And we still see that in the world today, don't we? But that's not what it's meaning. We're all to follow Christ. I mean, Chloe was a prominent person in the Corinthian church who had written or actually come to visit Paul in Ephesus to tell him of the factions in the church. And it's not known whether Chloe here was a male or female. It doesn't tell us that here, but it was a name in ancient Greece that could have been used on either side. So we don't know that. And I think today it's mostly female, but that's not what it once was. Paul quickly destroys the validity of such distinctions by insisting that all Christians are all one in Christ. Is Christ divided? He asks that question, and he shows the foolishness of even raising the question by asking two other questions that imply a negative answer. For Paul was not crucified for him, nor were they baptized in his name. And same could be said for Apollos and Peter. And so that's important. And so, is Christ divided? I mean, no human leader, not even an apostle, should be given the loyalty that belongs only to the Lord. Not only the great pastors of today or throughout history, that no matter how much we revere them, none of those should be anywhere close put on a pedestal to that of Almighty God. So that is not to happen. Christ isn't divided, and neither is his body. And his body is the church. And Paul appreciates his worth in comparison to the Lord Jesus, as all of us should. All right, let's look at verses 14 through 17. I thank God that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius, so no one could say that you were baptized in my name. Yes, I also baptized the household of Stenophetus, and beyond that, I don't remember if I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom and eloquence, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of his power. That's powerful. That's powerful what he said there. So let's break it down here. I mean, the mention of baptism leads Paul to comment that the Christian Corinthian believers had no reason to depend on the efficiency of baptism by him as a sanctifying grace, because he had baptized so few, Crispus, Gaius, household, Stenophanes, and these being the only ones he could remember as having been baptized by him. I mean, Crispus probably was, at the time, the head of the Corinthian synagogue, and Gaius was probably the Gaius that was mentioned as Paul's host in Romans chapter 16. But Stenophanes was one of those who Paul calls the first converts of Achaia, which is the southern part of Greece, where Corinth actually is, but it's also where Athens is, it's Sparta and all those other areas. But with Phantontus and Achaeus was with Paul. They were actually with him in Ephesus. And the whole household, family members and the servants of this prominent man had been baptized by Paul. But why Paul didn't baptize more during his stay in Corinth, we're not told. He does not go on to state that his essential work wasn't baptizing, but preaching in the gospel. That is, that baptizing was a secondary of importance. And this then gives him an opportunity to talk about the trust of his preaching, the thrust of his preaching ministry. I mean, his method was to preach not with words of human wisdom and not from with the cleverness of human argumentation, such as the Methodists used by those philosophers like Plato and Aristotle that the Greeks were used to. If he were to depend on human argument, the heart of the message of the cross would be emptied of its essential meaning. I mean, this verse doesn't mean that people should not be baptized, but that God didn't send Paul to start a private cult of people personally baptized by him. He was called to preach the gospel and to bring people to oneness in Christ, not to baptize a faction around himself. And so why did Paul say that Christ did not send him to baptize? That's a great question that one of you emailed over. It's a great question. I'm glad you're thinking about this thing. Paul wasn't speaking against baptism. Let me make that point clear here. That's not what he's doing. He was asserting that his God-given task was primarily to preach, to disciple. Paul did baptize a few people. However, it's possible that some of the Corinthians incorrectly believed baptizing guaranteed their maturity and security. And Paul seemed to downplay such views. And that's exactly what I was saying before. There's too many Christian denominations out there that wrongly want to say that if you don't get baptized, you're not there. What also puts people that, okay, I got baptized. So they have this false sensation of being assured salvation. Salvation comes in the heart. Baptism is of the heart. It's by spirit. And that's where genuineness comes from. Genuineness. I don't get dunked in some water and walk around for the rest of my life doing whatever I please. No, I begin to serve the Lord. I begin to take off the old self and put on the new. I begin to die to the self and to live for Christ. And that is what we are called to do in that. And so that is the difference. We aren't guaranteed salvation by simply being dunked in water. More than water is required to be a disciple. More than water is required to be a disciple. And the word is stud. That means student, right? And so that is important. Well, I hope you enjoyed today's lesson. It is a great one, and it's a tough one. If you have any questions that linger from today's lesson or as you're preparing for next week's lesson, again, you can email us at any time at rbgf22@yahoo.com. Again, we do not put a comment section here on YouTube or Rumble, and we do not have a chat going live. Because there's a lot of things that you guys need to ask and talk about that needs to be done in confidence. And therefore, the best way to do that is through a private email. And that's rbgf22@yahoo.com. So anytime you have questions, feel free to use that. In fact, at any time you might have other needs in life, maybe you're going through problems, you're dealing with something you just can't get rid of in your life. Maybe it's substance abuse or marital issue, whatever it might be. Feel free at any time, rbgf22@yahoo.com to get up. If you have prayer request, rbgf22@yahoo.com, send them over. We'll be glad to pray for you. In fact, if you have praises of something God just did in your life, man, we want to celebrate that with you. Definitely rbgf22@yahoo.com. And again, all this will be kept between ourselves and not for the whole public to chime in on a chat or something like that, because that is not the purpose. We're looking to build each other up, not to tear down. So we're not going to do that here in this fellowship. So we will be looking again at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 18 through 31. So it's the rest of the chapter 1 that we will finish next week. And we'll look at that in detail as well. You also, again, by subscribing on YouTube or on Rumble or Spotify, you will find other studies out there that we have completed in the past. They're all there. That you can go through at any time you wish. The Gospel of John is an awesome study as we walk through the entire Gospel of John together. We also walk through the book of Acts. And as you know, we're kind of infiltrating in our introductions to each of these letters a little bit from the book of Acts. So we can go back and remember what the historical record that was recorded by Luke about the events that took place there. So that's important for us that we do that. But yeah, go back through, walk through the book of Acts. One of the things that some people might ask is, or say, and I've heard this said too many times, but you know, I can be with God anywhere. I can be God out in the woods. I can be God on the mountaintop. I can be with God at the beach. I don't need to be in a church. Well, I think the book of Acts will tell you differently. And my friend, you need to be part of the local church. And if you're not, you need to be. I mean, Redeemed by Grace Fellowship is not meant to be a replacement or a substitute for a local church or a group of believers that gather together to study God's word, to fellowship and lift each other up in these trying times. But to be a part of a local church is important. Because God sends us and brings in these gifts that we're going to get into a little bit more for the purpose of us serving in the local church. Each member of that church, God has designed to have specific gifts that the church needs. And we'll break those down later when we get into them. But so the purpose of you being at the church isn't to get what you can get out of it. You're not going into a church looking for who has the best music, who has a good youth group, who has this and that. None of that is as important as where God wants you to serve. So if you don't have a local church, or you want some biblical criteria of what you should be looking for in a church, rbgf22@yahoo.com. Send us an email. We'll be glad to send you what that biblical information is that you need to be looking for in a church as you prayerfully consider where God wants you to serve. In fact, if you let us know what city you live in, we'll be glad to give you a couple of possibilities that you go check out and see if they match that criteria. But prayer is going to be, and let us know, because we'll be glad to be praying for you as you go and do those things. So, but yeah, the book of Acts is a great one. While we were doing the book of Acts, one of you sent over an email. Hey, do you have any kind of a class on, you know, the essentials of the faith and stuff like that? Well, there you go. Fundamentals of the Faith. That's where that it came from. And that is an awesome class. Every one of you should go back and take that, even if you already have, just because it was that powerful. It's there for you as well on that. And again, if you have suggestions for future studies, just like that person did, rbgf22@yahoo.com. I would be glad to take a look at that. This study that we're going through in the Pauline epistles is a recommendation that somebody gave us as we were in the Gospel of John. So to see this study. So here it is. So very much would like to hear any of those things so we can pray about it and say if that's where God would like us to go. It's Christmas time as we're filming this, and as we're in the Advent season, you know, we had a question one time, says, you know, we hear about Christmas all the time from the New Testament. Not that I don't like that, I love that, but you know, I sure would like to hear from the viewpoint of the Old Testament, the prophecies of the coming Christ, and through that. So that particular little short study through Advent is about a 10-lesson study, but it's called A Christmas of Old, Seeing Jesus Through the Eyes of the Old Testament. So check that out, too, here in this season as well. One other course we do have that you ought to probably take a look at, especially if you have children or grandchildren, is we have a little children's sermon. We've been doing about a year now, and that it's about a 10-15 minute thing for them where they could sit down. They'll have a little bit of fun, a little bit of exercises to go through with us, a few things to grab their attention a little bit. They'll watch a video each week, but they're going to learn a lot about Jesus too, and that is crucial, especially in today's world as they head out into the world. So lay those foundations with it, and you could pick that up as well for our sermons for kids. So yeah, join us for those as well. And if you subscribe to the channel, they will be able to get that each and every week that pops through. So that is important as well on that. Let me go back here. Yeah, bring me back. Scary. But yeah, do those things. And anytime you need to reach us, rbgf22@yahoo.com. We'll be glad to have you. So let's go ahead and close in prayer. And again, next week we'll be looking at verses 18 through the end of the chapter, chapter 1. But let's go ahead and close in prayer, and then we'll finish off by hearing the rest of the song, The Wonderful Cross. Let's pray. Almighty God, we're just so thankful that, again, we could gather today to open up your word. We pray that the things that you have planted in our hearts today, that you would continue to water them and to bring them, to nourish them and to bring them to fulfillment. And we thank you for that. Lord, bless again this fellowship as we teach each other and grow with each other. And those that would like to be part of this ministry, Lord, I pray that you would have them just email us. And would let us know what they might be interested in doing to help the ministry. I don't know, maybe they deal with technology or music, or maybe they deal with teaching, whatever gift it is that you've given to them, Lord. We would like to talk to them about that, pray with them about it, and see if it's something that you would want utilized. So, Lord, we lay that at your feet as well. Lord, again, bless our week and give us those in our path to share Jesus with. And may we be faithful to do exactly that, that they might be saved. And we just lift this prayer in the only name that we can, and that's the precious and holy name of Jesus Christ. And God's children said, amen and amen and amen. Well, love you guys. You have a great week this next week, and we will see you then. And we'll exit again, as I promised, finishing the song of the wonderful cross.